Уважаемые участники Московского международного форума инновационного развития «Открытые инновации». Начинается пленарное заседание «Российские институты развития. Взгляд извне, взгляд изнутри». Уважаемые участники форума, на сцену приглашается модератор дискуссии Сергей Гуриев, ректор Российской экономической школы, Джош Лернер, профессор Гарвардской бизнес-школы, Олег Фомичев, статс-секретарь, заместитель министра
Igor Agamirzian, the general manager and the chairman of the board of Ervicar, Anatoly Balor, deputy chairman of the Bank of Development and Foreign Economic Affairs, Vnesheconombank, Victor Vekselberg, president Skolkovo Foundation, Sergey Polyakov, General Director, Foundation for Promotion of Small Enterprises and Science and Technology, Anatoly Chubais, Chief Executive Officer, Chairman of the Executive Board, RUSNANO, Andrei Sharonov, the Deputy Mayor of Moscow, the Government of Moscow on Economic Policy. Esteemed colleagues, good morning. I'm very happy that we have the full house. And I'm going to speak English, and we are having the simultaneous interpretation. Some of our participants will speak Russian and English.
Before I move ahead, let me introduce the whole setting of this session. So what we did for this session, together with Russian government and together with Russian innovation development institutions, we set up a research project where we built a team that we'll introduce today, and an advisory panel of distinguished people from around the world who have experience in studying and actually doing innovation in developed and developing countries. And the goal of this study was to understand how Russian innovation institutions are functioning, whether they're achieving their goals, whether goals are clear, to what extent we can measure their success. So kind of an outside look at the Russian innovation institution, and of course institutions, and of course our main focus was on thinking how we can move ahead from here. And before I hand over to the leader of the team, Josh Lerner, let me also say a few words about people sitting here in the front row. Unfortunately, because of the hurricane Sandy, not everybody managed to reach Moscow, or actually fly out of New York City. But we do have people who flew out of New York City yesterday, so it's pretty impressive. And I'm very grateful to them. But first, from my left, this is Scott Stern, a professor at MIT Sloan School, professor of innovation. And Howard Cox, a partner in Grey Lock Capital, who's one of the legendary figures of U.S. venture industry, former head of U.S. venture capitalization. Patricia Freitas, who heads Brazilian venture capitalization, but she used to For many years, she established and ran Innovar program in Brazil. Itzhar Goldberg, who is now with Fraunhofer Foundation and used to work in the World Bank studying Russian innovation industry, and Erik Berglof, who is the chief economist at the BRD, who's also been one of the most profound scholars of Russia, and now in his capacity at the BRD understands Russian private equity and venture capital business very well. And now let me hand over to Josh Lerner, a professor at Harvard Business School, one of the most well-known scholars of innovation, venture capital, and private equity around the world. So Josh led the research team, and he will have about half an hour to present the main findings from the study, after which we will have a discussion with the speakers on the stage, but also with the floor. Josh, please, half an hour to present the study. Thank you.
Great. Thank you very much, Sergey, as well as for the chance to speak here. Can I bring up the slides which we have about the effort to the presentation? Thank you.
So. See whether we can get the technology to work here. We were asked to take a look at the range of Russian development institutions, very much focused on venture capital and innovation. And in particular, we asked to compare Russia's position in this area with the rest of the world. We would draw on a variety of analyses and particularly take advantage of the advisory board that we had to get a sense of what best practices were and whether there were some opportunities for going forward to learn from what was taking place and to improve it as a result. So we'll talk a little bit about the team and the methodology. We'll talk a little bit about measures of innovation and what we see here, as well as about the venture industry, and then I'll skip ahead to talking about some recommendations. So let's start with the team. Essentially, we had a team of people working with me at Harvard, which essentially did much of the interviews and the analysis. We also worked closely with Sergey and his colleagues at the New Economic School to get a sense of many of the empirical issues around here. As Sergey mentioned, we had a really all-star advisory board, which drew on expertise from very much around the globe, both from looking at the experience in the States and a number of emerging economies, and they very much served as a sort of check and a source of ideas for us. We looked at a range, and obviously we looked at the range of development institutions focused on this who are also represented on this panel. That was a little problematic. Let's try to undo that. All right, so let's be patient here and see whether something happens. Well, I think given the difficulties, perhaps we should just simply ask somebody in back to change the slides. So what we did is we essentially looked at data that was there. We did a lot of interviews with people. We essentially looked at it relative to best practices, not just simply in countries like the United States, but also in the other BRIC nations. And then we also spent a lot of time looking at data, saying what kind of data exists or not to look at this. Certainly one of the challenges we face that I'll just highlight briefly is that data is hard here. That while we perhaps are spoiled in the US and Western Europe of having a large amount of information about innovation, venture capital, and innovation institutes, here it was simply a lot of issues around definitions. There was a lot of inconsistencies in the data that was there. And it made it challenging to do some of these assessments. I think we could talk at length about why that is, but in the interest of time, we'll just present some of the data that we ended up finding. Most of what we did is looked at relatively simple measures, but the measures that we saw were really quite striking. And in particular, one of the patterns that very much stood out is that while Russia was high on many measures of innovative inputs, on innovative outputs, it was quite problematic in terms of the number of startup companies and other kinds of measures being produced. In particular, when we look at, this is not working very well, but let's, when we look at many measures of R&D, it looks, you know, sort of, certainly Russia looks quite respectable. And on other measures, if we looked at R&D as a share of GDP, Russia would be very comparable to the other BRIC nations, quite similar to China, Brazil, India, and the like. If you looked at a measure of PhDs, you would actually see an even stronger picture where the PhDs per capita is actually the third highest in the world relative to, and certainly considerably higher than the United States and any of the other BRIC nations. At the same time, though, there seems to be some real challenges. Again, ease of doing business, if you look at these measures, you know, Russia is very comparable to the other BRIC nations. There's really not a dramatic difference there in terms of what we see in these measures. But at the same time, there is something which is really quite different, which comes to the venture capital environment. And in particular, if you look at China versus Russia, and look at the amount of money being invested in venture companies, it is some 20 times higher in China than it is in Russia. If you looked at venture-backed companies going public, you see that it's a ratio of nearly 100 to 1. And similarly, across the other measures, it's clear that relative to China, but also relative to India and Brazil, the other BRIC nations, one sees a very much of a disparity of much less well-developed venture capital industry in China than in the other BRICs. And the natural question is why? Certainly, it's the case that Russia also generates relatively few patents, but even relative to the amount of patents that it generates less venture capital than one would expect to see. Here's another way of looking at the puzzle, looking at venture capital as a share of GDP. And again, it very much highlights, if we look at the, you know, it relative to other BRIC nations and other nations that we might regard as Russia's peers, like a South Korea or a Singapore, we see that the level is just simply far lower in terms of venture capital as a share of GDP. Entrepreneurship as well. If we look at high potential entrepreneurship, we see a much smaller share for Russia. In some sense, if we think about a cycle going from R&D at the front end to new companies at the back end, we see that Russia is very strong at the front end of the pipeline in terms of the, you know, the scientific knowledge, the research spending, the PhDs. But the challenge seems to be in the back end of the process in terms of translating that into new startups and into new products. And a very natural question is why is this? Why has this happened? One clue or one possibility might be that much of the R&D that's taking place is government funded. Certainly, if you compare these numbers to other nations, the Russian share is not only considerably larger, but also it's growing. So if we look at, you know, Brazil, India, China, we see that, you know, not only is the level of publicly funded R&D considerably lower, but also the share seems to be in most of those nations declining, that more and more of the R&D funding is being done by the public sector. So it seems that this is a case where, because there is this gap between the front end, the development of the science, and the back end, the commercialization, that there is a real gap that might well require policy intervention. That trying to create a situation where venture capital investment can work, that it seems there's a very compelling reason for seeing this as an appropriate strategy to follow here. At the same time, when we talked to people, we saw, you know, a variety of features of the venture capital market, which underscored some of the challenges of doing this development process. Some of the challenges that we highlighted were, again, we say it's quite small, it's hard getting data. There's certainly been some deals done by international firms, but certainly the degree of integration is not as large as one sees in many other places. We can look at fundraising, for instance, and we see that the share of emerging market venture and growth equity funding going to Russia is a very, very small fraction, that it certainly lags other regions, other emerging markets, in terms of its share. We can see the number of firms here, particularly domestic firms, is really quite small, and the data suggests that, you know, most of the deals that have been done by foreign firms. Inasmuch as deals are being done, they seem to be very much concentrated in the later stages, not in the initial stages of seed or startups, but really more in the sort of development and growth stages of financing. And when you compare it to either the United States, to Europe, and even to many emerging economies, you see that Russia is very much the venture capital that is taking place there, which is relatively small, is very much weighted to the later stages. It's probably fair to say that there's a lot more unevenness in terms of which sectors get funding, perhaps because the venture industry is so small. All it takes is one or two deals to move the mix very dramatically, as opposed to a market like the United States or Europe, where we see very much a concentration in areas like information technology and medical, biomedical as the key areas. At the same time, it's worth emphasizing that the performance that we see of the funds that have been active in the venture space is surprisingly good. So if you look at the data from the EBRD, which has certainly been the largest investor in venture funds in Russia as well as the CIS region, you know, having made, you know, well north of 1,000 investments in more than 100 funds, you see that the performance is really quite striking. That you see that the Russian funds, if anything, seem to outperform the benchmarks of other emerging markets, and as well as that even of Europe. So it does pose a question saying, if these funds seem to have done well, why is it that there's been so little venture activity in Europe? And what is it in particular that policymakers can do to address these issues? I think it's fair to say that we had, you know, a wide range of challenges that were highlighted in the conversations and the interviews that we had. This comment was an interesting one from a foreign venture capitalist. If you're not scared away, you can find some good deals. You know, certainly there's a lot of strengths here in terms of it. At the same time, there was a real set of concerns from the interviews about the venture market, saying that the ecosystem, the whole market in terms of venture activity, wasn't really that well developed, and that the venture firms themselves were, in many cases, didn't have a lot of expertise, there wasn't a huge number of serial entrepreneurs who could be drawn on for one investment after another. And there was a sense that while there was public funding available, and we'll certainly hear from it, that in a way, the complement to the public funding, having that private sector, the vibrant private sector, wasn't really there yet. So now I'm not going to talk about the individual programs in the interest of time, and I'm just going to focus the remainder of the talk looking at the recommendations that we put together for the program. In the report itself, we talk at length about each of the programs and gather the data that's there. But I think the most important thing is to highlight some of the conclusions that came from our analysis. So what we did is we put together first five guiding principles, which essentially motivated all the thinking and the recommendations that we put together. Then we did recommendations in three specific areas: about education, about the government, and about private capital. And in particular, with these recommendations, we highlighted both short-run ideas and long-run ideas, and we also tried to highlight examples from other countries that seemed to illustrate some of the principles that were there. So to just run through these principles for 1 second, we first emphasize the importance of focusing on ecosystem. That I think certainly one of the principles or one of the issues we see around the globe is that very often there's a tendency to say, if we just give money to entrepreneurs or we just give money to venture funds, that'll be all we need to do. And yet it seems that the real success, funding from the government may be part of it, but certainly another part of it is very much having the whole process work well, having the individual entrepreneurs, the knowledgeable funds, the whole range of players work effectively. A second principle was the importance of having more of a market voice. That certainly when we look at countries which have been the most successful at these, one of the important aspects is that they've had matching funds, where they've said, we as a government are going to hand out funds, but we're going to try to get signals from the market as to where the greatest opportunities are. Also, a question or a point around measurement, that certainly having good measurements around what's taking place in terms of activity, returns, and the like is extremely important. And in many cases, we don't seem to have as many of the measures as we would like to have in terms of really being able to assess what's taking place. Another principle is about missions, and in particular, the need to very much have clear missions. We spent a lot of time talking this morning at breakfast around this point, indicating that in some sense, it's healthy to have competition among agencies, that one doesn't necessarily want to have a situation where everyone is doing exactly the different things with no opportunity for overlap, but at the same time, having some degree of coordination and consistency in terms of policy seems to be an important aspect. And then the last principle we highlighted was the long-term nature of this, that I think one of the challenges that's happened in many nations is that they've started these efforts to promote venture and entrepreneurial activity and then gotten frustrated after a while that there wasn't enough returns after 2 years or 3 years. And I think that one of the important things that we emphasize is that this is very much a long-term investment, and it has to have a kind of commitment over an extended time period to really make this happen. We then turn to specific recommendations, and the first related to education. In the short term, we very much emphasize the importance of entrepreneurial education, making sure that there's a real cadre at all levels of the society of people who know what the entrepreneurial process is and are excited about the entrepreneurial process. And it ranges from everything from professors and corporate employees who might be interested in starting companies to students making them aware of it, people within technology transfer offices, and many other places. In the longer term, I think there's a lot of opportunities in terms of thinking about the science and technical education system. And think clearly Russia still remains very strong in terms of the basic science, but trying to integrate into it more opportunities in terms of the commercialization of that research. One of the other aspects of this is not just simply by educating people, educating Russians in Russia, but encouraging international connections. And that there is certainly opportunities to encourage both people to come into Russia as well as to have more students study outside of Russia to build that kind of cross-fertilization. I think there are many examples across the globe of programs that we could look at. Singapore has put a huge amount of effort into educating entrepreneurs at almost every level of society. The Innovar program, which Patricia was responsible for in Brazil, had basically a whole set of issues to educate both CEOs about how to get venture funding and what they need to do to be at a level of sophistication, as well as investors and institutions about how this process works. Another interesting example is Startup Chile, a program which essentially encourages foreign entrepreneurs to come to Chile in exchange for visas and funding, and with the hope that they are going to mingle with Chilean entrepreneurs and that they'll be learning from the interactions between the foreign and the Chilean entrepreneurs. Another area had to do with government. And again, there seemed to be a lot of opportunities for short-term gains. I'll just talk about a couple of ideas that came up and we wanted to highlight. One of them had to do with trying to remove barriers. Certainly, one of the points that we heard from many of the entrepreneurs and venture capitalists we talked about were some of the challenges around visa issues and customs issues and the way that this could serve as a barrier to entrepreneurs. In a sense that this would be, particularly today as innovation markets become more global, that this is an area where there could be a lot done to improve the process. Again, I think there's a lot of opportunities. There's already some efforts along these lines, but much more that could be done to expose the technologies that are developed into Russia to the global market and to enhance interconnections that are there. In the longer term, I think there are some opportunities in terms of trying to create greater coordination across agencies. And I think that one can think about a number of areas from tax policy to intellectual property and the like, where even though there's been progress made in recent years, there's still further that could be done to make these policies more friendly to entrepreneurs. Again, I think we can find a number of examples of countries that have done efforts along these lines. We've seen countries which have spent a lot of time evaluating and fine-tuning their programs, using matching funds as a requirement. We've seen examples of countries which have tried to centralize and coordinate the efforts, whether formally or by reliance on moral suasion, to make these efforts come together. A third area that we talked about was about capital. And here we had several areas that we thought were worth highlighting. Certainly one of these things was in terms of trying to get better data. As we talked about at the beginning, the availability of information around the Russian venture market is not as high as perhaps should be. And there's a lot of stuff that within the US or Europe one can know about the market, or even China one can know about the market, but just simply very difficult to get information on here. And that trying to create more transparency about the market is actually important in terms of trying to get foreign investors comfortable with investing here and making more of a commitment to the Russian market. Another area that very much seemed to be ripe for doing was had to do with encouraging outreach to foreign general partners, the people running venture funds, as well as limited partners. Well, certainly there have been a number of efforts done to date, in which I'm sure our very distinguished panelists will discuss, I think that more things can be done. That certainly one of the things that struck us as we talked to people in Silicon Valley is that there's still a lot of misconceptions about the Russian market that is out there. Another area that we could sort of think about in the longer term is in terms of trying to create some of the preconditions that are conducive to an effective market. One of these is essentially an exchange where it's easier for companies to go, which are backed by venture investors, to go public. For instance, the Chinese government has spent a lot of time creating a very high-quality secondary market called Chinext, which essentially has become a magnet for venture capitalists wanting to take companies public. Another area is in terms of trying to educate and encourage local institutional investors, such as pension funds, and to try to encourage them to know about venture capital and to invest in venture capital funds. Today, the Russian institutional investors, particularly pensions, tend to be quite conservative in terms of their allocations, and that adding and having a greater representation of risk capital would be quite important. So, and again, I think we can find numerous examples of countries which have done exactly this. All right, so let me end by, here we go, emphasizing a few thoughts. First of them is that while Russia has certainly got today many things that are, has many of the preconditions for an effective venture market, and we particularly highlight, the representation of PhDs, the strength of a scientific base and the like, it's clear that, despite those things, its venture market is lagging those seen in other BRIC countries. And that suggests that there is an important role for policymakers in this realm. It seems that the way in which the path to be most effective really involves focusing on the ecosystem and making sure that the ecosystem gets well developed, creating mechanisms to listen to the market and try to encourage market feedback, and then a process also of improvement and iteration to make sure that the efforts which are underway essentially respond in a sensitive kind of way to the market conditions. So those are a few thoughts, and hope which we've obviously spent much more time in the report that we will prepare laying out these in considerably greater detail, but hopefully this gives a sense of some of our thinking of the Russian market and some of the opportunities that lie ahead. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Josh. And indeed, it's very hard to, in 26 minutes, to give justice to the work that's been done and will be probably spelled out more in more details in the final report. Before we proceed to the panelists on stage, I would like the advisory panel members and peer reviewers of the study who are in the front row to probably give a couple of minutes of feedback on what they've learned during the study. What is like the single most important issue or recommendation to focus on for the Russian government or Russian innovation institutions? And with that, I would like to ask Scott Stern to answer those questions within a few minutes. Scott, what have you learned, and what do you think Russia should do to catch up in terms of innovation with the other emerging markets? Start speaking. No, it's not working. Yeah. The microphone's not working. Okay. Hello, can you put можно? Okay. Erik's microphone is working. Okay.
So first, thank you, and thank you to Josh for heading up and Sergey for heading up, I think, a very important effort to catalyze our thinking around the Russian innovation-based entrepreneurial ecosystem, some of the challenges that it faced, and the process of kind of moving that forward in both public and private efforts. I have to admit, I was, even though I've worked with a number of regions, many regions throughout the world, this is my first time to Moscow, and my first time investing and really understanding the Russian innovation and entrepreneurial ecosystem. And one of the things that struck me as Josh and his team sort of put together their report was the tremendous, if unrealized, capacity for Russia to be an international leader in this area. There really is a tremendous history of science, technology, and engineering basis. There are many, a basic human capital pool that can be drawn on for creating globally impactful ventures. But when you kind of look at the data, and even if you kind of look at, even trying to just cherry pick some examples, the fact is that some of the other BRIC countries, China in particular, seem, and perhaps Brazil as well, seem to have been able to translate that potential much more rapidly into commercialization, into the growth of globally impactful ventures. And so if I had to sort of pick, and this is going to reflect something that Josh said, but if I had to pick kind of an overarching principle that could perhaps infuse a tremendous amount of policymaking and investment within Russia, both public and private, is the notion of linking the public investment and the human investment in science, innovation, and engineering to the market, to commercialization, to the creation of new companies. As somebody who comes from MIT, that's spending a significant amount of time around the Skolkovo Institute of Technology, which is one of the institutions highlighted in this report, that's one of, I think, the animating principles between what we're trying to do and what MIT hopes to contribute to understanding how to move Skolkovo forward. But I see that as only one part of a much broader system in which sort of the actions of innovation, the actions of discovery and science are translated into entrepreneurship and the creation of global companies. Thanks.
Howard, you've been doing business in many of those countries. What would you say? What have you learned, and what do you think Russia should do to catch up with the other countries Greylock's been doing business in, and companies you're on the board of are doing business in? So.
Well, thank you, Sergey. I've been doing venture capital for 40 years, starting principally in the United States. I'd say the number one thing that I learned here from the data is what we all suspected, is that Russia has very little venture capital compared to many other countries. So this is the first time I've seen the data that confirmed what we suspected. I see this as an opportunity. I see it as the glass half full rather than half empty. Because if Russia has more money for venture capital, there's significantly less competition here than in other countries. In China, when we're involved in something, there's so much venture capital, there may be 10 companies trying to do the same thing, the same in Israel or India. Whereas here, if someone puts up some money to start a new venture, there's much less likely to be competition. So my recommendations would be one, for the universities that are here, the people who are on stage and the people in the audience who are in a position of leadership at the major universities, should be talking more about innovation, pushing innovation labs. I've seen this in the United States, where Harvard was way behind some other universities in terms of innovation. And in the last couple of years, a dean at Harvard Business School started the innovation lab. And now there's just a lot more entrepreneurship coming out of that. So I think it's the university leaders taking a lead in innovation, both talking about it for the professors and for the students. Secondly, I would say that for the people in this audience who have been fortunate to make enormous wealth, in the commodities and natural resources, it would make sense for them to devote some of their money to innovation. Our firm was started by wealthy Americans who thought that there was an opportunity for innovation, and they put up the capital for those of us to do the work. So I would recommend that some of those people in the audience who have been very successful should find a Russian who is working outside of Russia and have been successful in venture capital, but perhaps not the managing partner of a firm, and offering him a pool of capital to come back to Russia and to start a venture firm. The amount of money, relatively speaking, to other countries is small, I think. In other words, a $100 million venture fund here, I think, could be very, very successful, whereas in the United States or China, one needs a lot more than $100 million. So I believe there is the resources here for one family or several families to come together, create a pool of $100 million, recruit several partners to come back and to start companies, and I think there will be an opportunity to make a number of successful companies and a lot of money. So I'm suggesting that this is not something to be done for the Russian government or for charity. Rather, it should be done for self-interest, that there's an opportunity to build major companies and to have those financial rewards.
I would like to ask Patricia Freitas, who's been running a similar program in Brazil for many years, Innovar. And Patricia, what would you recommend Russian government to do?
Thank you, Sergey. Thank you, Josh, for the opportunity. First, I think that Brazil and Russia, we have many similar challenges to develop our industries. So I think there is a lot of opportunities for sharing experience. Second, I think I've learned that each country needs to design the program that better fits to your reality, but at the same time need to be simple and need to look at the international best practice. And why this? Because you want to have a sustainable and lasting industry. So I think this is really important if you want to have a global industry. And the other thing is that I've learned that you are top three in the scientific background, and I think this is really important, and you have this huge opportunity to transform all this technology into new companies here. So you have to fulfill this gap, and venture capital is the oxygen for this activity. It's really important to foster the industry here. Regarding like recommendations, I can tell more about what I've learned working in Brazil. And we did a lot of effort as a government to become more as a maestro than an executor. So we try to coordinate efforts all the time since the early beginning of the project. And now many of the projects that we started are being running for the private sector. So the government is not taking this role anymore. So I think this is important as a government agency to think about who will be the role of the government after 10 years. So this is one recommendation, and also matching private sector funds. It took much more time to do that than to do like whole 100% fund by government, but it's really worth at the end. And thank you.
Thank you very much, Patricia. Indeed, in Russia, government has a long tradition of being an executor, but in English, you know, the word execution have different meanings. One is doing things, and the other one is cutting heads off and punishing. Yeah, so Russian government has been an executor for many, many decades, and indeed, being a maestro is probably a very different role from that. With that, I would like to ask Itzhak Goldberg, who's who's been studying innovation industry in Russia, Israel, Europe, and the U.S., and can share his views. Itzhak, please.
So first, I want to say that Professor Lerner and his team has done a lot of work in such a short time. I am working in Russia for 20 years, and I still have a long way to go to understand Russia. So that's really was very interesting how much they did in a few months. However, I have five comments, some of them more provocative than the others. I am a little, I'm not sure I agree with the focus on venture capital. This focus actually comes from the field. In Russia, for the last 10 years, we talk about...
It's please mic to...
In Russia, for the last 10 years, venture capital has been the main point of discussion as far as innovation goes. I mean, to me, the first question to understand is why Europe is so different from America. So America seems to be the only place when there is so much venture capital, and we usually compare, that still has to be explained. And whether Russia is closer in terms of conditions to Germany, in terms of market structure, say, that will maybe partly explain why Russia is where it is on venture capital. And the point is there a point to keep trying to make Russia like America, or maybe it should be like Germany? The more basic thing about venture capital is that after a few years of it's putting billions into venture capital, I was the World Bank at the time, and some people from the government said, well, you know, we have invested all this time, but all this money into this venture capital, but there's no deal flow. There's no pipeline of so-called bankable ideas. And the question is, why? Let me tell you the story of Israel that was mentioned. Israel has put money into matching grants, the one that were mentioned very rightly so. For 20 years between the 70s and the 90s, before the venture capital started, now it's one of the largest in the world. But the basic thing is you have to build your deal flow for many, many years before you get private entrepreneurs risking their money on this idea. So that, to me, is an issue of, I mean, where's the point? You have an institution like FASI, the foundation which is giving out grants, which I think, relatively speaking, is quite good. And I have been following for many years, and it's not growing, or it's not growing significantly. So where are the matching grants of Russia? FASI is smaller than the whole program, the program in Israel, let alone the size difference. And I can tell you that in per capita terms, the US SBIR is seven times bigger than the Russian FASI, and the Finnish tech is 28 times bigger. So I don't understand this asymmetry between the investment in venture capital vis-a-vis matching grants, which are supposed to build the deal flow. Now, this presentation is very rightly focused a lot on the matching idea. It's interesting to compare, and many countries I mentioned, Israel, Finland, Chile, have matching grants, while the US SBIR, the Small Business Innovation Research Program, does not. I put that as a question, why? There are all kinds of theories, which I'm not sure I understand, but we just should know that. Basically, the idea being that you have to, at least some scholars say, to help the company to pass the valley of death before you ask it to put in money. I'm not sure I understand. I'm not sure I agree with that. So that was point three. Quickly, four and five, I think we learn a lot from the, it's called co-inventions, patent in which you have a Russian and usually a German. These have been, these joint patents registered, say, in the EPO, in the European agency, have been growing significantly much more than the local patents. That's a fantastic phenomenon of R&D collaboration, I suggest to. That's a place where the state can intervene and support. And last one, I would suggest to look in the final report a little bit on this question of picking winner and targeting. This is, I would understand, a policy of the Russian government. There are alternative approaches, it would be nice to say something about it as well. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Erik, what would be your take, given that EBRD is indeed a leading investor in VC and PE?
Yes, thank you, Sergey. So I think Josh and his team has done an amazing work, particularly in putting together the data. So one thing that struck me when I came to EBRD was how little data there was across the region, and how little we did with our own data. We have done some work, but we have a lot left to do. So I wanted to focus on two of the recommendations or sort of principles that Josh pointed out. And the first one is focus on the ecosystem. And I think it goes even further than his presentation alluded to. And I think when you think about what is needed for innovation, it's a very, very broad range of factors. And you know, the puzzle that he presented, you know, why is Russia different from other BRICS, unfortunately, I think comes from so the other side of where there's so relatively little innovation in Russia, and that has to do with the resource dependence. And I mean, we have gone over this so many times, but it's reflected in almost every aspect of the ecosystem. It's about the distortion of skills, the lack of management skills. It's about the low entry and exit of firms. It's about an improving but still lower level of competition than we would like. It's about the missing middle, I mean the lack of middle funds, middle-sized firms. It's about lack of, or the weaknesses of the financial system, particularly for early stage finance. And of course, it's also about the broader business environment, which is extremely important. And of course, these affect innovating firms much more. We have done you know, some work on this. You can really show that the key problems that managers face in Russia, the skill, access to skills, the corruption and also customs is affecting innovative firms much more. It's also affecting foreign firms. Foreign firms are often a very important source of innovation in emerging markets. And also it affects exporting firms much more. And exports are very important for innovative firms need to spread the cost of innovation on larger markets. So as Josh was saying, addressing this is going to take time. It requires efforts on a lot of different areas. There's certainly a role for policy. The second principle that I wanted to address was the listen to the voice of the market, and I certainly agree with this. On the other hand, it's understandable in Russia that perhaps listening to the market has not been so obvious, because the market has been extremely volatile. The signals that you get from the market has not really been very reliable. You know, you can't blame so this policymakers for you know trying to do something, because you know the private sector wasn't really delivering, and you know, there are many reasons for that. But and particularly the gap was particularly large in Russia, and there has been indeed a number of initiatives here. What I would like to focus on is exactly the it's about matching, of course, and most of these institutes are matching. And are trying to co-invest, and of course EBRD is also part of this. What I would emphasize also is the importance on in the long term to get matching into the governance and eventually let these initiatives become fully private, and as have happened in many other countries. So bring in private sector, again EBRD can be part of facilitating that. But I think that's an absolutely critical part of the long-term evolution of these institutions. So I think it's very important work, and I'm very much looking forward to the comments from the panelists.
Thank you very much, Erik. So I would like now to run a quick vote. Please take your voting devices, and to activate it, please press any button, but better press sign in button. And then we'll put the questions on the screen. And basically, after you've heard all of this, we've seen that Russia has a huge potential and huge opportunity, but it has a number of problems. And so we put four potential answers onto the screen, which is lack of innovators and innovative ideas, I guess that has been mentioned. Lack of financing through private or public money. Third is problems with the business climate for innovators, so innovator-specific problems with the business climate, and poor political legal institutions generally, courts, customs, rule of law that are generally characteristic for business climate. So please vote. And then we'll turn to the next part of our panel. Press 1, 2, 3, or 4. Okay. Результаты чуров. Должны быть. Okay. So these are the results. We have electronic voting system, so the results are almost immediate. It's not a final result. We still have some people voting. So results are still changing. So I suggest we vote for another 30 seconds. Please make up your mind. Every person has only one. Every person only has one vote. So if you've already voted, you cannot vote again. This is in those terms. This is a very clean voting system, and the counting is done automatically by a computer. Okay, so let's close the voting, and we saw that the main problems are in the rules of the game, and some people believe that these are innovator-specific rules of the game, which are a big barrier, and some people believe that this is general business climate that is a problem. And in the presentation, we've heard a number of issues related to those barriers. And with that, I would like to give floor to Oleg Fomichev, who is Deputy Minister for Economic Development, and within the ministry, he is responsible exactly for innovation development. And I guess it is his job to be a maestro of Russian innovation sector, rather than the executor. And we'll talk to executors later; they're also on stage. But now to the maestro, Oleg, пожалуйста, что вы скажете? Согласны ли вы с
Oleg, what will you say? Do you agree with the opinion in the audience, what the Russian system manages and what it doesn't manage to do? What are you going to do? Thank you, Sergey. Based on the voting results, one thing is clear. We have no problems with financing. So it turns out that all other problems are so huge that even our financing issues are seem to be so small. Very quickly, let me comment on the presentations and the voting results. I thank you very much for a very comprehensive study. A few points that I'd like to make with respect to the dynamics and the percentage, the share of public and private financing, and the fact that the public share is growing. There's a couple of things that I'd like to note with respect to Russia. Number one is that this government spending on innovations will not be reduced. And if you take the specific numbers of the budget financing in line with percentage to GDP compared to international numbers, we are more or less in line with the standards in developed countries. The problem we have is that this share of private financing with the same public financing will not be reduced. The private share should grow manifold. And issue number two, this budget part, the public part, makes us different from other developed countries, and that is that unlike most developed countries and the BRIC countries, we have a large-scale portion of fundamental science, something that the government should spend on. However, the proportion of these fundamental science sector, while we're saying that a lot of money is being spent on science, the innovation results are not as palpable, so most of the financing goes to fundamental science, not applied science. This is indeed an area where innovations grow and the part of the governmental R&D spending are there, but they all go to the innovative sector, commercialization, applied research, then, of course, the return on that investment in terms of patenting and specific innovative products will be greater. This is not true for Russia, but the sector that is still small in terms of public support, but the support in terms of innovation activities, this is something that we should pay more attention to. And I've always support this, and I support what the experts have said with respect to the need to dramatically increase financing on early stages of R&D. I believe most people will agree, and not just Sergey Gennadyevich. He will not be the only beneficiary, even though the key one. And a couple of years ago, we had this unique phenomenon, the signing of a letter by research institutes to the government to have money allocated so that they have enough money for projects to continue into further steps. This is something that the government has to do. Unfortunately, we're not managing with this, to do this every year. The government, with colleagues from development institutes, tried to do the same thing, insisting on have increases, but still, as part of the budget, public budget, in the second reading, the reallocation of funds, again, a little bit of money that was added was reallocated again in favor of fundamental science. So we support fundamental science as much as we can, but again, fundamental science as such is supported at the expense of commercialization, something we would like to avoid. Now, briefly, with respect to the study itself, I mentioned the positive that I have an overall positive evaluation, but the impression I get is that in the course of the research, the experts, since they're all very high class and they're used to work with high-level issues, this high level has led to the fact that we've shifted the focus somewhat from expert review and audit of the system of development institutes to an issue that is always more pleasant to discuss for international experts, and that is, what shall we do with the Russian state? The focus in the research ended up with an evaluation of the Russian innovative system. And in a number of cases, just literally repeated the words from our innovative development strategy, something that the government sees as its strategy in the area of innovations. So in this respect, I would like us to change our discussion towards development institutes, because the innovations mentioned in the presentation of the experts are clear, understandable, and these development institutes were set up especially for these to address these. And the question is how they're coping with the problems that our experts are talking about. For instance, this small percentage of venture capital was the reason for venture capital companies being established, so that capital from venture foundations investing in specific companies, so that they increase the share of venture capital in the Russian economy. How they're coping, how they're doing, this is something that myself, as a person to a user of the audit findings is missing. So we have a number of questions that we would like answered. The role of private investors in the development institutes, because recently we have more and more unpleasant signals where as development institutes, not as part of the investment lifting support projects at different stages, but when all of them start supporting them at the same stage, because that's easier. One of them gave money, mitigating risks, because the other one gave money as well, so everything's fine, everybody's invested, but there's no major strategic private investor. Then the awareness of market players about the development institutes. What is it? Is it high, low, transparency? Is it working? Focus on key areas? Is there this focus? Is it sufficient or not? The internal efficiency and performance of development institutes, the corporate governance, is it in line with international best practices? The responsibility areas, do they overlap? We heard that they do. They need to be reduced, but to what extent and in what area? We'd like to have an answer to this as well. So this is a number of questions. Maybe it's in the report. I didn't hear that in the presentation. So in this respect, I'd like us, as part of this discussion, to try and respond to those. Thank you. Thank you very much, Oleg. Indeed, as part of a half an hour presentation, it may be too difficult to answer or impossible. And when we, in preparing this research, we've interviewed, when I'm looking at this audience, and every fifth person in this room was interviewed, let alone all those sitting in the panel. And we've collected answers to most of the questions you're asking. Indeed, there is a lot of international best practices answering these questions. I agree with Patricia that some of the questions will not be answered without your involvement. You will have to make a choice, having in your head all the other components of governmental policy in the area of investment. To continue our discussion, I believe we have this high-level picture of the world and your specific questions to the development institutes that I think we can start answering right away. And I believe we should start from the left and go to the right. We have the so-called innovations lift, and I think you're right in saying that it doesn't always work one way. Sometimes it goes in circles. It doesn't stop on every floor. Sometimes it stays on one floor. Sometimes floors get confused. So maybe we should start moving from left to right. Andrei Sharonov, who is not part of the lift for the time being, so he can allow himself to speak as a new person, a relatively new person in this area. He can be fairly frank. Yes, I don't represent development institutes. Fortunately, the city is not and should not be a development institute. The city is an environment that brings together all the, encompasses all this. And I am grateful to the researchers for this interesting study. I will probably disagree with Oleg, who said that the key conclusion is not about development institutes but fundamental governmental institutions. And I believe that this confirms the Chinese saying that 1,000 small boats will not go for a big ship. So innovations throughout the world will not replace our fundamental institutions, which make it possible the coexistence in the interests of innovations. This is another signal to the effect that we should see the entire picture and not be driven away, I mean the government, not the professional community, not being driven away, drifted away. And we should remember that it all should be on the basic foundation. So the city is not a development institution. It's an environment. Yesterday, we had a breakfast where one of the venture fund representatives from the U.S. who operates in Russia said that they relocated from the Silicon Valley to the state of Utah, and they like it very much, this lonely place, but thanks to communications, they feel comfortable. And the Microsoft representative said that you should not exaggerate, and the innovators find it more comfortable to live among in cultural and scientific centers, Moscow being one of such cultural centers. And the claim of the city is confirmed in this respect to be one of the world innovations centers. So the city is an environment for institutions. In this specific case, the institutes represented by my colleagues on this panel, and an environment for innovators who either choose or don't choose a specific city to do what they like. And I believe that the most critical role for the city to perform is to be complementary, to complement, to add, not to duplicate, not to dominate, considering itself a main expert, including in innovations. And from this perspective, we think it is important for us, if you look at the entire chain of the growth of innovation companies, it is important to do this work, organizational and financial, that leads to the establishment in the city of business incubators, technoparks. Just 3 days ago, a center of innovative development was opened, which is intended to be a one window for all players, participants of this innovative community, both money, venture capitalists, development institutions. Moscow has so many opportunities already there, and unfortunately, we know so little about them that this connectivity, as they call it, the opportunity to connect these institutions in the interests of specific venturists and researchers, this is very small. And our objective is not to continue multiplying the number of institutions, but to try and learn to explain how to use the existing opportunities. They're already there. They are expensive, that have been established by the Federation, by the city, by the professional community. Another important point that I'd like to make is that we should view innovations, I mean us, the city, not as a means to satisfy specific needs of the city, because more often than not, I hear people say, when we speak with innovative institutions or portfolio companies, this question, where can we use that? Nowhere is the answer. Don't even ask that question, because if you buy it in America, Europe, Australia, you pay a lot of money for it and it's competitive, then you should do it. This is not a means to satisfy the needs, utility needs of the city. This is a way to attract and retain people in the city who want to do innovations, which is a very thin layer, and you know it better than I do. It's an elite that, as positives say, have some positive externalities for any city. This is a very thin layer that creates expensive jobs. This is the world elite that makes the world elite come here from time to time to anchor here and maybe even base their businesses here, their offices and subsidiaries and so on. So this is a way of life. We always talk about how we want to see the city, but this layer, staying here, growing here, will change the way of life, the lifestyle. This is why we want to do, to promote innovations. That is why Moscow has become one of the co-founders of this forum. Besides, the existence of these people confirms the fact that Moscow is the place to be. This is a place to work. This is a place where you can do it to achieve your goals. This is the way we see the role of the city in this difficult chain. Thank you. Thank you. You've mentioned some very important words. We spoke about that. There's no city municipal innovative market. This is an environment and people succeeding in major markets, because the markets work in such a way that either you exceed, either you're ahead of everyone or you lag behind. I'd like to give the floor to Igor Agamirzian, the general director of the Russian venture company, who in particular has one of these initiatives, the internationalization of the Russian innovative business. And I believe that Igor can tell us more than that. Thank you very much, Sergey. To begin with, speaking about development institutions, you need to understand the task they're working on. And I don't think it's mentioned anywhere, it's stipulated anywhere, but I believe the development is about developing the economy and the innovative development strategy, as defined by the ministry and approved by the government, contains specific KPIs for the share of a technological economy in the national GDP. That's one side. The other side is that the work of these development institutions depends a lot on the institutional environment and the investment and business climate, something that, by the way, in the course of this voting, the results of which are very close to my personal convictions, I have seen this very clearly. Unless you have a relevant investment and business climate and the basic institutions not impeding the economic development, no development institution can be efficient. Therefore, as regards the presentation of the results of the study, I have mixed feelings, because I have issues with the methodology and the specific data. Something was missed, some data were inaccurate, but it's not that bad, because this is a preliminary version. And then the methodology. You look at everything using the push model when you consider the so-called linear chain of science, commercialization, business. In fact, the technological business works not according to this model. It works in the opposite model, of when first there's a demand from the market. And the science, in a sense, creates a ambient environment conducive to the creation for specific economy, specific products. A minor, very tiny portion of scientific discoveries are taken that are the basis of technical and technological products that define the development of the economic development. So I would view these things from a totally contrary perspective. And the way the study formulated the problem, it makes it even more complicated. It means that we are unable to hear what the market is saying. We have a huge demand in this country for high-tech products, while the Russian economy fails to meet this requirement, this demand. For example, mobile telephony. The growth rates and the advances in the use of mobile communications are much higher than the average world levels, and we have a national producer to develop the entire system. The Russian economy is not correlated in any way with the market demand. This is a systemic issue to be resolved. This is a need of the demand of the market, and the Russian national and global thing in this respect, what was said about internationalization, I support this, and I believe this is a very relevant task today, because in a modern technological economy, there are no successful products or services targeted at national markets. They're always global. They always meet the needs of the people, which are about the same all around the world. So despite my issues with respect to the this study's methodology, I still agree almost totally with the conclusions, because what it says in conclusions and recommendations, they coincide almost literally with our development programs that we're being implementing here. And then RBC, for a number of years, has been having its internal study on an annual basis. It's not as large scale as the one presented here today, but still this year we've interviewed some 60 people from the leading, in our, as we see it, players from categories like our own stakeholders, representatives of other development institutions, ministry, people from the venture business, leaders of Russian high-tech companies. And besides, we completed this internet poll, open for our internet audience, and we have collected a few hundred responses. And the tasks solved here are slightly different from the ones in the research, in this study. Questions were slightly different. But still, the question is, why are we doing this? We want to understand the current priorities for ourselves as regards our work for next year and see the dynamics of change. Well, this study is not over yet. We're on the business planning stage, but the preliminary results are already clear. So according to our results, financing is not even on the top 10 priorities. And the first three priorities that we've heard identified by almost everyone are coordination of development institutions, incentivizing of demand for innovations, and the development of the ecosystem. Stimulating and the promotion of ecosystem are the two things that depend on the development institutions and the business environment, because there's no other significant vehicle to incentivize a highly competitive environment in the world. This is a everything else is a partial way to resolve the issue, and we need to be we need to reform the institutions in earnest. We should become more and more transparent. It is very well known that one of the impeding barriers are in restrictions like customs, currency regulations, visas. Come on, these are obvious things. If we are to improve the attractiveness of Russia for science, at least for international conferences in Russia, how can't you make it a visa-free entry for academics coming here? This is a very elementary. Football players can come in, and people who are part of the international world development elite need to spend months to obtain an entry visa. This is a shame. How can you expect Russia to become an innovative center if cannot even hold a scientific conference? And this is just one example of hundreds of other instances. Measures needed are radical for development institutions to be taken. And then the objective is set, it's formulated in the presidential decree to go from the move from number 120 to number 20 in 10 years, no, in 6 years, yes, in 6 years already, as regards the business environment. Okay, in the last year we had this big step. We somehow moved from a number 120 to number 112. Well, I'm sorry, but there's still 92 more points left to overcome, and we have very specific restricting control. We need to open everything to raise attraction. I just can't see it possible. I can't imagine how this can be done. We have this objective for 25 million highly productive jobs to be created in the economy over the same period. How can you create highly productive jobs when you have this institutional environment and these restrictions on the business that exist in this country? I'm sorry for being so emotional about it, but I am strongly convinced that there are a number of absolutely fundamental points of principle. There will be no financing. No financing will be efficient unless you have the required business environment. What we're doing in terms of financing today is wasting people's money. Thank you. I'm finished. I'm done. Well, thank you. Different institutions have a different amount of people's money. RBC is somewhere in the middle of this lift, and now we are moving slightly to a less ambitious program for the waste of people's money, the so-called Bornik Foundation. A lot was said about it today, and you probably forgot about the law on state traders that urges us not to speak too much with foreigners in order not to get into prison. Well, Sergey Polyakov, okay, your lift is going up and down, and but that's okay. I'd like to comment on what Igor said, because we've exchanged sitting here. We agree that globally the problem is here, but since I represent one of these development institutions in the beginning of this innovation cycle, I'd like to speak about it, because I believe that the quality and value of any study is determined by its practical application. That is why we believe that when the final report is ready, because we've seen just the main points of that report, it will contain specific recommendations, first to us, the development institutions, but then also, no less important, is for the state and the government, because maybe perhaps this will be a last drop, because we respect very much the lobbying work and the care towards our foundation. And you heard Oleg Fomichov, it's not just words. This is real facts, and probably today, in preparing for the second reading of the budget, we will use very much expert opinions from all around the world as regards the use of funds for early project phases. But we don't claim to be exclusivity. This is an organization that's probably specific in terms that it's been using, it's been doing presentation of examples during all of its life. And in the middle of the 90s, the foundation's budget was very small, and we tried to show how efficient the government support can be for SMEs. And then, of course, the state let innovations, maybe they didn't need them. And then now we have some good companies grown that have now become even middle-sized and big-sized companies.
And it so happened that the state understood that you cannot live without any support to innovative industries and small business. And in the middle of 2000s, we launched the projects of seed and pre-seed financing. And we try to demonstrate to the state how effective it is to invest at the early stage, starting from the school and the student bench. When you support the young scientists, they are developing the ideas and results in the research, which might be the foundation for that kind of business. And this is a kind of a demonstration for what we do is not suffice for Russia. Only 500 startups and 2,000 young researchers per year. This is not enough. Although the budget grows, and we spoke with Itzhak Goldberg 5 years ago, and he said how small amount of money you are investing, and now our fund grew 5 times. It's in general numbers, but we need to see the rhythm of this growth. And when we speak about the increase of the resources, which are channeled at the initial stage of the development, but which demands most of the resources, it is quite obvious that at present we have to manifold increase the investment into this sector, and not only funds should be part of it. And this RVK seed fund is working nicely, and the other organizations should work, like the business angels, and as they are successfully working in Europe and America, and the scope of funds which need to be concentrated in this area, both budget and private equity, should grow manifold. And we will try to use your recommendations, and this should bear a global character for investment ecosystem in Russia. With this, I suggest to vote once again, and we have heard some opinions about what we lack, and let's vote once again. And again, we have four possible problems to discuss, and Sergey talked about this, the lack of resource at the institute's disposal, the lack of clear goals and the criteria of success, and also the state institute will crowd out market mechanisms. And let's try to vote quickly within 1 minute to give the answers. Some 20 minutes, 20 seconds more, please. All right, thank you very much. You may very well see the results on the screen. So we don't see any competition between the institution of the development, although the thing that people do not have strictly outlined criteria and goals to achieve success. And perhaps I wanted now to pass the word to General Manager of Open Stock Company RUSNANO. And criteria and the goals have been outlined in percentage of the market in rubles. And Anatoly Borisovich, you have the floor. Well, I thought that there is no competition, and this is true. I agree that it's a paradox situation, non-tradition situation for Russia, when the institution of development is not trying to choke each other. And this is unusual situation, some kind of corporate cooperating and stimulating. And along with the subjective reasons, there is one more reason, and the reason is the general scope of goals which the Russian development institution is facing may be dozens of times greater than the scope of their abilities. If you could assume the goal to create the innovative Russia, the country of our greatness, diversity, enlarged territory, and the capabilities of all who are sitting here and those who are present in the hall, this is thousands in this most complicated multi-vector and multi-stage system should be generated, created, and born. And when we try to answer the question, and what is the most important thing, so where is the major chain or link, it's not easy to answer this question. And I would agree to what Igor Rubenovich said, that the investment environment, the business environment is the major obstacle, and without competition, you can't create innovative economy. And I would put my signature against these statements, because we are spending, well, I will not agree that we are spending in waste the money of the people here. But if we try in the most complex system to find the main nerve where it is located, so first you have to make this simple to begin with, to make it very simple and primitive to the ultimate, and then try to find this point from which we could start. So we have a sphere of fundamental and application research, and we have underdeveloped to a great extent the sphere of commercialization approach. So we understand that this kettle with boiling water, you can't pour a cup of tea. There's a bottleneck there, and perhaps there is one of the major problems of the time. And I don't think many countries could be proud of such a fundamental base for innovation to compare it with Russia. And in terms of actual innovative brands, we have nothing to be proud of. And in this respect, the point where there is a core, and Oleg Vladislavovich also spoke, is the point, it's the seeding stage and pre-seeding stage. And this is the breaking point, and we have to understand that we are now spreading our efforts in many fields. We are trying to accomplish something, and we need to complete. But if we would like to identify the major link, what would I do to unbind this knot? First of all, I would forcibly, in the democratic traditions of the time, redistributed the federal budgets for the missions which are related to the pre-seed and seed stage, with the international grants, with the fund of Bortnik, who proved that he could operate without any corruption in Russia. And of course, there will be protests. It will be understood, but it should be done despite of the resistance. And I'm sure that the return for the country and benefit for the country would be dozens of times greater. I would definitely also add it to this effort, the money from the regions for pre-seed and from the seed. If you are going to seed Kamchatka from Moscow, it means that a lot of seeds will be lost on the way to Kamchatka. And there will be 10 to 15 regions of Russia, which really demonstrated some efforts. And in these regions, the task of the budget support of the seed is possible to be resolved. I very well understand the budget situation there, and the mission here and the task is just to support the regional efforts for budget support of the seeds that these regions are capable of, just to support by co-financing, let's say, for the region of Kaluga, what would be a reasonable size of seed, maybe 50 million, 100 million rubles per year. And I'm sure that could be supported by the federal budget. And I would also activize to invite the Western competence on a pre-seed and a seed stage. And this is an absolutely correct approach. 500 startups, and they should be invited here. And we had an excellent practice in science field on order 219 by inviting prominent Western scientists, and I would attract also those Western companies who know the seed and pre-seed technologies and demonstrated positive results. I would analyze the situation, successful experience, federal law 217, and what grew out of it. I think we have today about 800, maybe 900 small business appeared during the last year. We have to help those who make who made their breakthrough. This is our own know-how and our competence, and we have to build up these efforts and support. Along with what I said, that the seed is the most important stage and the most important link, which requires additional support and help, I think one more thing is also, which may run contrary. Don't rush ahead, I would say. The country has chosen the way for innovation and modernization. There is a lot of talk going on that the new president is not willing to do that and everything. No, he haven't forgotten it, and we see that the course is not changing. And we see about the financing of Skolkovo or Bortnik Fund, but we understand that we are responsible. And we see that the country is moving in the same direction. And further on, the most dangerous thing is the story. Today, you have planted potato, and tomorrow you have digged it out because we need to put something on the table. We need to be patient. Maybe another 15 years, if we pursue this way, we will get innovative Russia. Thank you, Anatoly Borisovich. Of course, if you go steady along this course, and of course, some discussion will also be required today. We were talking about the pension fund, and the reform of the pension fund could completely destroy the accumulative part of the pension system, and a number of other risks and tendencies, also budget priorities, which are being discussed today, not exactly correspond to the strategic direction which was chosen and you were talking about. And we also heard from some experts that it takes not just 1 or 2 years. You can't create innovative business or system in 2 years. With this, I am passing the floor to Viktor Feliksevich Vekselberg, and who is building with his own hands with Skolkovo infrastructure. Thank you very much, esteemed and distinguished colleagues. I share what our partners spoke about the institutions of development, and I would like to share with you at a specific example what we do, results which are tied up with the commentaries which were made by the working group, and to a great respect, these estimates and appraisals, they corresponds to our understanding of these tendencies. And one of the tasks to support the innovative process, it is the creation of ecosystem. And the mission of the Skolkovo Fund is we have to create the ecosystem and eco-environment which will support and ensure development of innovative processes and extrapolation of our experience to the whole territory of the country. We are a little bit more than 2 years old, but we believe we have made success and we are on the right track. And we have about 700 companies, residents, and our concern that we will come across the deficit of interesting flux of ideas and investment projects. So we are receiving on a weekly basis about 40 requests or applications, and we choose 7 or 8. And I think the numbers which we wanted to attain with 5 years to develop, let's say, 1,000 companies, we will reach this number much earlier. We also signed an agreement with more than 20 global companies about the partnership, who decided to establish research centers and to actually, this is a bridge to the global market, which will help us to ensure proper communication and understanding how their products are in demand of the global market. And third element, which is extremely important, this is venture capital. Mr. Cole also said that we have a fairly weak venture capital, but as far as our fund, we have signed with more than 30 venture funds, which took their responsibility to invest more than $1 billion, and we don't have the projects, but the money is available, and they participate in this work, and I'm sure that it's going to be a guarantee of our success. And actually, a year ago, we have created the Institute of Science and Technology together with MIT. We are working actively in this direction, and the first 20 students have been sent to different international institutes. They will come back, and we are going to have 70 students. We have established 3 educational centers, and we are moving in absolutely correct direction. And the next, of course, this is the city, the environment where our residents, our people, their families have to live. We have designed the master plan, and we have created the first building. We called it Hypercube. And those who don't know the master plan, at Venice Biennale received a special prize and actually excited the participants of architect community how creatively we have approached this project, and we believe we will be able to accomplish it fully. And of course, this environment, when they start their chemical emerge, so that will contribute to creation of the environment. And as far as the painful issues we were talking, we also think about the visa support. We have signed a visa support with the Federal Migration Service to ensure support to our employees within the Skolkovo project. We created a customs post which simplifies the entry of necessary materials, expandable materials, and this is a positive trend now. As for today, by having solved the quantitative problems, and I would like also to draw your attention to the quality, how could we measure the quality of the result of what we did? And here, actually, the biggest problem is we cannot use the results of intellectual work which is available in our country. Last year, all leading companies of Russia registered 1,000 patents, if we take them all. And one Microsoft registers more than 2,000. So, of course, we are lagging behind in this direction. And a special center was created in the framework of our project. And only our fund has prepared more than 90 applications during the last 6 months. This is a good potential. We need to learn how to use it. Next element, which was also mentioned here, is the ability to react to the market, to watch the market closely and understand the tendencies. What do we see here today? In our country, we see negative comments that we have distortions in the economy. The energy sector companies are dominating, and as a rule, with the accent that this is our past and we have to move ahead into the world of the advanced technologies, in something like IT or others. And I would like to defend this sector of economy. And we have a tremendous advantage. We have the most powerful market for the most diverse demand for most various innovative products. And we have to used to cut the best pieces for our innovative projects. And I can give you at least two examples of today. And one of our companies has sold a license to a leading energy company for the right of the use of the software which simulates hydrocarbon formations. And we are approaching the market which initially seemed to be impossible to enter. And at the same time, the great company Rosneft has signed with one of our residents about the creation of the pilot plant to manufacture synthetic fuel from associated gas. And Rosneft is actually oriented itself on the Western technologies, but they consciously took this decision that you have the bearer of this knowledge and intellectual potential. It means that we have our indigenous abilities. We need to learn how to use it. So the role of our fund which we have to ensure the success of this environment and ensure support, administrative and financial. They should see their success where we have the success of the resident companies. And I can't but comment one more thing. About 1 year ago, maybe not in the same hall, but in the same conference, by estimating the situation, I told that today we are at the stage of crossing the minefield in terms of how we are structuring our innovative economy. I can't say that this impression has ceased to exist, but I believe this became less acute. Well, actually, the state, and I would agree with Mr. Chubais, that priorities of the state have not been changed. The innovative approach remains, but commenting the results of the voting on the first issue, where the majority of those present said that the first reason, which is an obstacle on our success to structure this wonderful future, is the environment. And here I'm catching myself with a thought that we bear something from the past, from the Soviet past, and we think that this environment is built only by the hands of the state. We participate in this all. And the fact how actively we are going to support the initiatives which are having an embryonic stage of development, we have to cherish all this. And the representatives of educational, engineering, scientific community, if they demonstrate their activity and support, I'm sure that altogether we will guarantee the achievement of the success. And I think I would like that after this conference, each of you would leave this hall with a feeling that something depends on those who are present here, and we will combine our efforts and we could achieve fairly interesting results. Thank you very much, Viktor Feliksevich. And I think in the end, we will vote for this to see how, what is our attitude to the innovative business. And I would like to give the floor to Anatoly Balo, deputy chairman of the board of directors. And he is involved in the investments into the projects in the companies, and perhaps he is the largest player on the Russian investment market, and he is responsible for these things. Yes, we stand on top. However, the elevator comes to our place very rarely, and there are some objective situation and obstacles. And my colleagues expressed those concerns. And at the same time, I would like to tell you about our vision from the inside, why it happens. First of all, I'd like to confirm that the state is tuned to switch our economy to innovative rail. And the fact that the mandate of Vnesheconombank, which initially was given only for infrastructural development of the country, has transformed into innovative rails. And the confirmation of this fact, along with the branch priorities, we have number one in place, those five directions which were identified by Mr. Medvedev: the energy saving, nuclear energy, and high tech, microelectronics. Unfortunately, these are the directions, as was truly mentioned here,
by our previous speakers, there are not so many much bankable projects. And it's clear that for the banks, it's much more easy to prepare digital projects in other fields rather than in IT. At the same time, practice shows that you can't orient yourself only on the Russian market, and unfortunately, nobody is waiting for us on the international market. And here, one of the moment is to prioritize in innovative direction. We think we must concentrate those directions where we have our competitive advantages and where we have certain advances in scientific schools. We don't have many of them, but we need to support and develop them. And specifically, I'd like to mention that Vnesheconombank has created a number of subsidiaries, like the Export Crediting Agency, but for planes and helicopters, nobody is knocking on the door. We have created the Russian Fund of Direct Investments, and basically, we are discussing the projects in the base branches and not in the innovative fields of economy. We also created web innovations. We should consolidate all innovative activity of the Vnesheconombank group. However, we don't have much of improvement here. And the second, I have to talk about consolidation, for we have many institutions and government bodies to participate in innovative process.
Today, before this session, at the breakfast, the question was raised, and who's responsible eventually for the innovative development? Because the Ministry of Industrial Trade, who's supposed to be responsible for the technical industrial policy, often does not adequately take the necessary measures, and we are victims of the system that we've had in place since the Soviet Union. Very recently, I learned that as part of the Academy of Sciences, there's more than 500 institutes. I would support Anatoly Chubais, who said that we should seed, because what you seed is what you harvest. And VEB is an institution that can only take profitable projects, and we have no right for an error because we are not venture capitalists. We can only afford to take bankable projects. It is my subjective opinion that the reason why we don't have so many venture capitalists, because we have objective reasons. Our market economy is less than 20 years old. Look at our banking system. Most of the players are government-owned, state-owned banks, because the initial accumulation of capital is still in progress. And at the same time, the government can be understood as well. The reason why they're not using golden and currency reserves for innovations. This is because in most cases, there are no success stories. Like Viktor Feliksevich mentioned those brilliant examples that we've seen. Unfortunately, there's only a few of them, and the lack of success stories leads to a situation where, on the other hand, on the one hand, the government believes this is a black hole, and it's better to export mineral resources and enable the integration of the national economy in the international economic space. And finally, least but not last, is the incentives. We have this positive example in the Kaluga region where we've financed the infrastructure of an auto cluster, and the Kaluga region all of a sudden turned from a recipient of public funds, turned into a donor. As a result, the Ministry of Finance reconsidered the allocations immediately for the region, and as a result, the region became a victim of its own innovative policy, because all our public and budget system does not incentivize neither the regions nor the companies and enterprises to innovate. To conclude, let me note that going back into history, you can compare this with the reforms by Peter the First, Peter the Great, who sent the most talented people overseas to get trained and then come back and head up enterprises here. This dates back 200 years ago. And the objectives of the development institutions are more compressed. And I would rather agree with Mr. Chubais that we should not rush, we should wait, and then the result will not make them wait. Thank you, Anatoly, very much. We started a little earlier, and we have a couple more minutes, so we now have the opportunity to vote. You all have your voting devices. Please use them. Press the button. The question is, do you believe, or what will the Russian innovative system look like in 10 years from now? Not 200, but 10. This is what Anatoly Beloy spoke about. Let's look at the prospects, because the processes now develop much faster, and what used to be a black hole years ago, and the country was supposed to feed their peasants. Now Russia is one of the major grain exporters in the world. Maybe everything will change to the better, including innovation. So let's vote. Let's take a minute to vote, and I will ask a question to Oleg Fomichov. Who's responsible for innovations in the government? Who's the in charge of innovations? Who's the person in charge of that? Is there such a person at all? Is it yourself? Is it you? Vladislav Surkov. He's responsible for the innovative development. But he's got other things to do, other work to do. He's, yeah, of course, he's head of the government office. Okay, so unlike other countries, unfortunately, this is not the priority number one for the government, since it's assigned to a person who's got other responsibilities. Okay, another 5 seconds, and we will be concluding. Let me agree. The priority is, I will disagree. The priority is fairly high. This is the first among equal, the deputy prime minister, Mr. Shuvalov, and then he's also chairman of the of staff, head of staff. So he's in the center of decision making. Thank you very much. Then we were right to do this because this study was targeted at you as well, and you and Vladislav Surkov. Hopefully the research results will be more specific, more concrete, more down to earth for the development institutions, and they will be described in the report by the end of the year. And once again, I would like to ask that the results be shown on the screen. Most have chosen the second answer. I believe this is a fairly optimistic option. Indeed, Russia will build up the share of innovations in its economy. It may not become a world leader, as 62% of the respondents think. And this is slightly cools down our optimism. And this is a considerable progress will be made, as most of the audience think. So this is something to congratulate you with. And I'd like to thank the panelists and the audience for a very interesting discussion. Thank you very much.
Спасибо.